Only our brother, Martin Luther King, exhausted a means of nonviolence with his life being taken by some racist. What is being done to us is what we hate, and what happened to Martin Luther King is what we hate. You darn right, we respect nonviolence. But to sit and watch ourselves be slaughtered like our brother, we must defend ourselves, as Malcolm X said, by any means necessary.
At this point, I question the whole purpose of the Black Panther Party. In my thinking, they were necessary. It was a shock treatment for white America to see black men running around with guns, just like black men had saw white men running around with guns. Yeah, that was a shock treatment. It was good in that extent, but it got a lot of black people hurt.
There was no joke about what was going on, but we believed with our hearts that we should defend ourselves. And there were so many that did do that.
By 1968, the Black Panther Party was part of an increasingly volatile political scene. That summer, the National Democratic Convention in Chicago was disrupted by violent clashes between demonstrators and police. The war in Vietnam polarized the nation, and the political and racial upheaval at home soon became an issue in the presidential campaign.
This is a nation of laws, and as Abraham Lincoln has said, no one is above the law, no one is below the law, and we're going to enforce the law, and Americans should remember that if we're going to have law.
I think it's fair to say that as the Nixon administration came into office, as we came into office in 1969, there certainly was a strong perception of radicalization.
In Chicago and in other cities, FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover expanded surveillance of organizations in the black community, especially the Black Panther Party. Directives issued by FBI headquarters a few weeks after the elections called for, quote, imaginative and hard-hitting counterintelligence measures aimed at crippling the Black Panther Party, unquote. On Chicago's west side, the Panthers had just opened their first office in Illinois.
Well, the thing that I really loved about the Black Panthers is that they refused to be ignored. It was very easy to ignore black people back then because everybody figured, well, it's just a lot of talk and they're not going to do anything. They'll just go on and on and on, moaning and groaning about how terrible everything is. And they, of course, at the best, they just might get involved in some acts of nonviolence. But that's about it. And they just kind of, you know, business as usual. You couldn't have business as usual with the Black Panthers. The Black Panthers were definitely going to be heard.
So we always say to the Black Panther Party that they can do anything they want to us. We might not be back. I might be in jail. I might be anywhere. But when I leave, you can remember I said with the last words on my lips that I am a revolutionary. And you're going to have to keep on saying that. You're going to have to say that I am a proletarian. I am the people. I'm not the pig. You've got to make a distinction. And the people are going to have to attack the pigs. The people are going to have to stand up against the pigs. That's what the Panthers are doing. That's what the Panthers are doing all over the world.
Fred Hampton, a former NAACP youth organizer, became at age 20 chairman of the Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party. The Panthers program drew mixed reactions in Chicago's black community.
Many black people initially was very, very afraid of the Black Panther Party.
I understood where they were trying to go politically and felt that they had to change things. And when I talk about fear, I was afraid they weren't going to do it right. And I was always trying to cool them out and say, that's not the right way to go. They were too direct.
You could tell that this was a movement that was very meaningful to them. And none of them were suicidal, so it wasn't like they were out there trying to figure out a way to get killed. But they did honestly and truly believe in power to the people. I mean, that was their slogan.
Here you found some brothers and sisters saying, first, you know, look, the United States Constitution guarantees us the right to bear arms and to protect ourselves. And we understand that we need protection in the black community. And it's our responsibility to protect black women and black children, not the police. Because the police is not here to serve and protect us, only to continue to enslave us. It is our responsibility to see to it that our people have a decent place to live, decent food to eat, and quality health care, not the system. So that frightened a lot of people. I mean, they didn't think that it could happen. They didn't think that it was right.
People learn by example. I don't think anybody has an argument with that. I think that when Huey P. Newton said that people learn basically by observation and participation, I think that everybody caught on to that. So what we're saying very simply is that if they learn by observation and participation, that we need to do more acting than we need to do writing. And I think the Black Panther Party's doing that. That we didn't talk about a Breakfast for Children program, we've got one.
Come on in, little brother. Come on in, little sister. Y'all can sit down and get something to eat.
Sisters and brothers.
Y'all take off y'all's coats. Sit down, man. Everybody's gonna eat. Y'all can eat as much as y'all want.
The new Breakfast for Children program soon attracted the attention of the FBI. Claiming the program served to indoctrinate children, the Bureau directed field offices to, quote, formulate specific counterintelligence techniques to disrupt this nefarious activity, unquote. The FBI stepped up its efforts to recruit blacks to infiltrate the Black Panther Party.
My recruitment by the FBI was very efficient, very simple, really. I'd stolen a car and went joyriding over the state limit. And they had a potential case against me, and I was looking for an opportunity to work it off. And a couple of months later, that opportunity came when FBI agent Roy Mitchell asked me to go down to the local office of the Black Panther Party and try to gain membership.
I think everyone that was in the Black Panther Party kind of understood it was a given that we would have wiretaps, that we would be followed, that we would be harassed, we'd be locked up, that we would even be beaten by the police.
In the winter of 1969, law enforcement agencies launched efforts to undermine an attempted coalition between the Black Panther Party and the Blackstone Rangers, a Chicago gang.
The Panthers were pursuing an ideology that said, we need to take these young minds, this young energy, and turn it into part of our movement in terms of black liberation and the rest of it. And I saw a very purposeful, intentional effort on the part of the police department to keep that head from hooking up to that body. It was like, you know, do not let this thing become a part of what could ultimately be a political movement, because that's exactly what it was.
FBI agents wrote an anonymous letter to Jeff Fort, the leader of the Blackstone Rangers, warning Fort that the Panthers have, quote, a hit out for you, unquote. The Bureau knew that the information was false, but believed that Fort might take retaliatory action against the Panthers. Meanwhile, city officials announced a crackdown on gangs.
Would you say that street gangs can do no good? Is that what you would say?
No, I wouldn't say that. I think that the energy of youth properly directed could be a tremendous betterment, could lead to a tremendous betterment of our city and the individuals' progress themselves. I'm complaining about the misdirection. I'm complaining about the fact that 620 out of 693 shooting victims are black themselves. And I think that's a tragedy. That is where black genocide is occurring here.
The Chicago police expanded their anti-gang campaign to include the Black Panther Party. In late May, Fred Hampton was sent to prison. He had been convicted on a charge of stealing $71 worth of ice cream bars.
We tried to develop negative information to discredit him, just like we did everybody else. We, meaning the FBI, I tried to come up with signs of him doing drugs or something, and never could. He was clean. He was dedicated. I've had private conversations with him. We got along pretty well.
While Fred Hampton was in prison, a police raid on the Panther office turned into a shootout. Five policemen and three Panthers were wounded.
They did it.
After they got the brothers down, they went back up there and the fire started.
Nobody was up there except the police when the fire started.
Right. Frank, you want to come
get a picture of that dude? Man. Yeah, check that door, man. Magnified shotgun.
Shot up the door at the office there.
arrested some Panthers. And just to show you the nature of the raiding officers there, they burned boxes of cereal that we had on the third floor. And they deliberately set fire to that. They didn't set fire to the second floor. They set fire to the third floor with all the, you know. That was kind of indicative of what they were thinking and how they were moving.
The idea on the part of the police was to psych the community out. They called me up the next day. I says, is the office open? Well, no, the police boarded the place up. I say, open it back up. You got the lease to the place. What? I says, open it up. Take all that boarding down, paint that place. And the Black Panther Party members start working for a couple of days. The next thing you know, the community start bringing wood, paint, and everything, and open that Black Panther Party office right back up. And of course, this was an attempt to terrorize us out of existence. At the same time, if we would close down, it would leave the Black community saying, well, they stopped them.
In a report made public in the summer of 1969, FBI Director Hoover declared the Black Panther Party the number one threat to the internal security of the United States.
I think, frankly, that he overstated the concern, the real concern that the Black Panthers were to the country. I think it was legitimate for him to state that they were a violent and unlawful element. But referring to them as the most dangerous or most important, and I don't remember exactly the words he used, the greatest threat to the United States at that time, I think, was an overstatement.
The police community is sort of a built-in reward and punishment system of its own, and you get a lot of rewards when you go after who the boss says is the bad guy and you get him. And I think what J. Edgar Hoover was able to do was to give police officers the impression that it was okay, it was open season. You didn't have to worry about the law. You didn't have to worry about the difference in the executive branch of government and the judicial branch of government. I think what he in effect said is it's our ball game, guys. We've got the authority, we have the capacity, let's crush him.
Panther leader Fred Hampton was still in prison, but efforts were underway to appeal his conviction.
We were successful, and we got him out of jail towards the end of that summer because a Supreme Court justice in the state of Illinois looked at what kind of a person he was, looked at the kind of case it was, and gave him appeal bond. That's the first time I saw Fred Hampton, and I was in a young white student in a predominantly black church, full to the rafters, welcoming Fred Hampton back.
Okay, you put your hands down now. We say all power to all people. We say white power to white people.
White power to white people.
Brown power to brown people.
Brown power.
Yellow power to yellow people.
Yellow power to yellow people.
Black power to black people.
Black power to
white
people.
X power. We go out, we drive along to some schoolyard or something, and there are like 200, 300 people waiting there for Fred to show up. And the phenomenal part was that, I mean, these are all people from the streets, I mean, who are not going to get up and go to work or anything else, and never had no discipline and never would. But there they were, and it was 6:30 in the morning, freezing Chicago weather. And Fred would have them out there doing push-ups and jumping jacks and getting themselves energized for the day's work, which included making the breakfast, which included selling papers, which included working in the medical clinic, which included a bunch of stuff. It was a very day-to-day kind of a thing, the Black Panther Party. And you'd have Fred out there rallying them, and he'd say, all right, all right, all right, power to the people. Everybody said, power to the people. He'd say, now, I'm not going to die on no airplane. Everybody said, no. He said, I'm not going to die slipping on no ice. They say, no. He said, I'm going to die for the people because I'm going to live for the people. They say, right on. He said, I'm going to live for the people because I love the people. They say, right on. He'd say, I love the people. Why? And they say, because we're high on the people, because we're high on the people. And that was Fred Hampton. When you saw this was 21 years old. It was unbelievable. You could not be moved by Fred Hampton.
In the fall of 1969, Chicago was the scene of a controversial trial. The defendants were leaders of the anti-war demonstrations that had taken place during the Democratic Party convention. National Panther Chairman Bobby Seale insisted on speaking in his own defense. On October 29th, trial judge Julius Hoffman ordered Seale bound and gagged.
This is a symbol to every one of us. Black men in our courts are gagged. Black men in our courts do not feel as though there is any justice. Black men in our courts, whenever case they come, feel that judges do not understand and are without mercy.
2 weeks later, a gun battle on Chicago's South Side further escalated tensions. A former Panther and two policemen were killed. The deaths provoked a response from informant William O'Neill's FBI contact.
Mitchell became more specific during that time. He wanted to know the locations of weapons caches. He wanted to know if we had explosives. He needed to know who was staying at what locations, who spent the night where. His information didn't change so much as he requested more detail. And I knew why. The shootout on the South Side had pretty much laid the foundation. Within the party, within the Black Panthers, we knew that the police would react some type of way.
Expecting police action, the Black Panthers had fortified their office. FBI informant O'Neill was now head of Panther security in Chicago.
We're very confident that nobody's coming in the front door.
Nobody getting on the roof, Jim. I want you to know that.
Nobody getting on the roof.
You believe in, fire, cover, and fire?
Yes, we do defend our offices and we do defend our homes. This is a constitutional right. Everybody has it. Nothing funny about that. The only reason they get mad at the Black Panther Party when they do it is for the simple reason that we're political. And they don't want to admit this. There are a lot of young organizations around, but we're a political organization. We're an organization that understands that politics is nothing but war without bloodshed, and war is nothing but politics with bloodshed.
On November 19th, FBI agent Roy Mitchell drew a floor plan of Hampton's apartment based on information supplied by informant O'Neill. On December 4th, at 4:45 in the morning, 14 policemen, 9 white and 5 black, raided the apartment. Deborah Johnson, 8 months pregnant, was asleep in the back bedroom next to Fred Hampton.
The first thing I remember after Fred and I had went to sleep was being awakened by somebody shaking Fred while we were laying in bed, saying, "Chairman, Chairman, wake up, the pigs are vamping, the pigs are vamping." This person that was in the room with me kept shouting out, "We have a pregnant sister in here, stop shooting." Eventually the shooting stopped and they said we could come out. I remember crossing over Fred and telling myself over and over, "Be real careful, don't stumble, they'll try to shoot you. Just be real calm, watch how you walk. Keep your hands up, don't reach for anything, don't even try to close your robe." When I was in the kitchen, I heard a voice, an unfamiliar voice, say, "He's barely alive, or he'll barely make it." Then the shooting started back again. Then I heard the same unfamiliar voice say, "He's good and dead now." And I knew in my mind I assumed they were talking about Fred. And I knew when I left out of there, I couldn't look towards the room.
Party leaders Mark Clark and Fred Hampton were killed in the raid. 4 of the 7 surviving occupants of the apartment were wounded. All were charged with assault and attempted murder.
When they locked me up at the police station, I kept begging them for a call, to make one call. I called, I think, the office, the Black Panther office, and I spoke to Bobby Rush, and he told me that Fred was dead. Fred had been killed.
And I remember walking out of the office and looking through a little clearing over on the next block, which was right in front of the Monroe Street address, and seeing a lot of police cars over there. And at that time, Bobby Rush came to the office. He had just come from over there, or maybe the coroner's office. In any case, we walked back over there and we both were speechless. We just walked through the house and saw where what had taken place and where he died, and it was shocking. And then I was, you know, I just began to realize that the information that I had supplied leading up to that moment had facilitated that raid. I knew that indirectly I had contributed, and I felt it, and I felt bad about it. And then I got mad. You know, I had, and then I had to conceal those feelings, which made it worse. I couldn't say anything. I just had to continue to play the role.
FBI headquarters authorized payment of a $300 bonus to informant William O'Neill for, quote, uniquely valuable services which he rendered over the past several months, unquote.
They came in our community just like a thief in the night. And they just snatched Fred's life just like that, you know. And it's just like, why? Why? This brother, they have done nothing to none of you all. The only thing that this brother has done was to instill a sense of pride and dignity and self-determination in his people.
State's attorney Edward Hanrahan gave an official account of the raid to the press.
As soon as Sergeant Daniel Groth and officers James Davis, who were leading our men, announced their office, occupants of the apartment attacked them with shotgun fire. The officers immediately took cover. The occupants continued firing at our policemen from several rooms within the apartment. Thereafter, three times, Sergeant Groth ordered all his men to cease firing and told the occupants to come out with their hands up. Each time, one of the occupants replied, "Shoot it out," and continued firing at the police officers.
The press at the beginning had taken Hanrahan's line. This was a shootout. 200 shots were fired. The Panthers fired half of them. Nobody was really challenging that, except a young Sun-Times reporter by the name of Brian Boyer, who went down there, and he saw the evidence. And it didn't take a genius to look at what was there and see that all the bullets were going in one direction, and all those bullet holes were pointing towards Fred Hampton's bedroom and the middle bedroom where Verlina and Doc Satchel and everyone was.
Conflicting descriptions of the raid made headlines in the Chicago papers.
The account that we made public yesterday gives a detailed explanation of what happened in that apartment. I stand wholeheartedly behind it as absolutely accurate.
There is one inconsistency in, well, for example...
I do not intend to quibble about that account.
Do you intend to get at the truth?
The account that we gave of the events is the truth.
State's attorney Hanrahan supported his account with photographs intended to prove the Panthers had fired at the police.
We went, took those pictures, and saw they weren't what they appeared to be. The back door, the circles around the bullet holes, they turned out to be nail heads. We went and we saw that they were nail heads because we had possession of the apartment. As far as the door that the Panthers were really supposedly firing into, that turned out to be the bedroom door, and it was the door that the police had made into Swiss cheese with their machine gun bullets.
The controversy grew.
This blatant act of legitimatized murder strips all credibility from law enforcement. In the context of other acts against militant blacks in recent months, it suggests an official policy of systematic repression.
The Black Panthers preach every day, hate, kill whitey, kill the police, kill the pigs, hate, hate, hate. That's all you hear from them. They expect those police officers to walk into that apartment with pea shooters? You've seen the guns that were there. What were they there for?
Members of the Black Panther Party were taking people from the community through the apartment so they can actually see what was going on. People were able to go through the house and they were lined up all around the block in the cold in the wintertime to see what actually happened.
Don't touch nothing, don't move nothing, cause we want to keep everything just the way it is.
Don't touch no walls.
This here is the room where the first brother, Mark Clark, was murdered at.
Even if they want to take somebody to jail,
It'll be a simple matter of just shooting some tear gas in here to draw everybody out.
Right on. This is where our chairman had his brains blown out, and he laying in bed, sleeping at 4:30 in the morning.
I think that the police waited till the 17th of December to actually seal that apartment. So it was open for almost 2 weeks. And we spent a better part of those 2 weeks getting that evidence out of there. And so we would be talking to people when they went through. And so while we were working, there'd be people walking through constantly. And I'll never forget, I don't know what day it was or what, but I just remember some older black woman coming through there, shaking her head and going, "It's nothing but a northern lynching."
The people who had just come purely out of curiosity were saying, "This is atrocious." This, even law and order people were saying, "This is unlawful and it's disorderly. And it's obviously not part of what I want to condone in terms of my law enforcement or my taxes to be protected. This is not the police function here." People realized that there had been a trial, a conviction, and an execution in that house.
You know, it can happen to any of us. And that was fear, shame, you know, sorry. What could we do? Why couldn't we have protected Fred?
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things that I should say.
I had a mass for Fred, and I was just shattered. I was devastated. And in the midst of this mass, I was trying to explain to our children, because we had all the school children there, all 1,300, and I was trying to explain to them the importance of Fred. And I wasn't getting through, and at least I felt like I wasn't getting through. And in the midst of my explanation, I just burst into tears. And the next thing I knew, here was one of our eighth grade boys. He jumped up and he said, "I am Fred Hampton." And then a girl in sixth grade, she jumps up, "I am Fred Hampton." Another kid in first grade, "I'm Fred Hampton." And before you knew it, the whole church, kids were all shouting, "I am Fred Hampton." And wow, I just felt so wonderful. I felt like, gee whiz, this death was not in vain at all. Because these kids are saying that they are willing to get up here and speak out for liberation, for first-class citizenship.
In the weeks that followed, public pressure led to a series of investigations. An FBI ballistics expert established that all but one of the more than 90 shots had been fired by the police. All charges against the Panthers were dropped. No police were indicted. But the families of Hampton and Clark and the survivors of the raid sued the government for violation of their civil rights. Years later, the case was closed when federal and local governments and the police agreed to an out-of-court settlement of $1.8 million. The scope of the FBI counterintelligence program, COINTELPRO, began to emerge in 1971 after political activists broke into an FBI office in Media, Pennsylvania. Stolen FBI files documented extensive FBI operations against U.S. citizens and organizations, including traditional civil rights groups. Amid growing criticism of the counterintelligence program, President Richard Nixon reaffirmed his support for the FBI during graduation ceremonies at the Bureau's National Academy.
"I am honored to be here to break into your graduation ceremony to reassure you and all of the men in law enforcement throughout the country of the support you have at the very highest levels in government for your work. And I am honored to speak for the entire nation in saying to you congratulations, wishing you well in seeing that this nation is one in which we will have respect for law, in which the American people can have freedom from fear."
We had talked about police brutality. The Black Panther Party talked about the police as an occupying force in the community, but we had not really understood the extent to which the whole criminal justice system, the police, the courts, the prison system, is very much intertwined with the economic oppression of black people.